just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Yeah, absolutely, because I can't
prove either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Good day to you, citizens of Netlandia. Welcome to ORLY Radio number 113A, recorded Friday, June 10th, 2016, where we dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that make you go, oh, really? I'm your host, Andy Cowen, with my usual suspect, Daniel Atherton. I need to remove all of those other names from the script. But no, it's just me and Daniel today, and I do have a canned response from good old Fred Sims, who is unable to join us in the flesh this evening. Daniel, how you doing?
Doing pretty well.
And, of course, your video is frozen immediately. I love it when a plan doesn't come together. Hang on. Okay, five.
Be a show without technical difficulties.
It wouldn't be. It would not. Well, it wouldn't be the right show without technical difficulties, because everyone knows that there has to be at least one glitch per show, I think. I think that's a rule. Not positive on that. But so hopefully that'll be our glitch, and then we'll be fine. There you go. Now you're live again. There we go. Okay, moving pictures and all that. Which, by the way, if you're getting us just as audio through the RSS on, you know, iTunes or Stitcher or Spreaker or any of the other various podcast aggregating outlets out there, then you're missing all the video. We have a full multimedia extravaganza for you, available out streaming every Friday on our Twitch channel, or of course every Sunday-ish, Monday morning or Wednesday morning for the show A and show B drops, which is the first half and the second half eat your vegetables part of the show. At least that's the way it has been so far, with the good news and the bad news and really getting the in-depth stuff. That seems to be the back half of the show. Which is funny, because we're always super tired then. Maybe that's why we ramble so much. Maybe I'm rambling now. I'm probably rambling right now. Maybe that's just the show. Yeah. I see what you're doing there. Yeah, just a little bit. Uh-huh, yeah. But, you know, it is still predominantly audio, so your visual cues, well, maybe your camera froze. I won't even know. You see? You're going to have to verbalize what's going on. So, which... everything's going to be archived at the wonderful people over at YouTube land. Well, youtube.com/ORLYRADIO. That way, I don't have to pay for any bandwidth when you download the video. I mean, let's be honest. That's why it's there.
There.
So, exactly. So, last we met, I'm not sure exactly which one it was, but we were talking about gunshot wounds with sponges in a cock gun syringe thing.
Yes.
This got some attention from one of our audience members, and awesome. we do make mistakes, or we might say something that you simply have to comment on. And if you want to do that, you can email us at orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com or andy@orlyradio.com. I've now got that working too. Or you can also phone it in at 470-222-6759. So from the mailbag, there we go. Andy, I love the coverage of the gunshot wound cock gun. I had an insight that I think it's accurate. The conversation seemed to overlook a key element, clotting factor. See, my nephew has a mild bleeding disorder. He's not of royal lineage or anything, but it takes him about 20% longer than normal for a cut to seal up. He's talking about the royal lineage of hemophiliacs. A lot of the inbreeding and things like that to keep the bloodline pure ended up thinning the blood itself. Kind of weird that way, but that's what he's talking about there. Okay. So, see, his specific condition is a lowered amount of clotting factor that forms a web or lattice-type structure around a wound, which catches the platelets. Once it catches enough to clog the lattice, it is sealed. I imagine this technology would work the same way. So it's not just the sponges swelling to fill the wound, it's also them catching the platelets to make a hemostatic seal. Typically, this clotting factor will start forming around the edges of a wound and build upon itself. That's why You want to pinch a deep wounds that aren't likely to seal up. It makes me ridiculously happy, Orlyish. So, all the love, Daniel Bible Pants Duncan. He's from the Kentucky Fried Free Thought podcast, and I hope to have him on the show relatively soon so that we can do a little cross-promotion there and see what he's all about. He's a good guy. Met him at ReasonCon a year ago, a little more. Yeah, so good guy, really good guy. So, also one of our Patreon supporters, they found a wonderful video that they shared with me. It's only about 3 minutes, and I think it's going to be pertinent to the discussion this evening. So,
Vegetables are already coming.
The vegetables are already coming. This is your first course of vegetables. Hopefully, they're tasty. Now, let me see.
This is the asparagus appetizer that's on the menu.
I don't think you should start with asparagus. And your video is already frozen again. I love that.
Hey, yeah, I'm consistent.
No, it's not you. It's the Avermedia HDMI capture box that I have running. For some reason, it's just not a happy thing. But it's sort of there. Okay, let me get this video here. It's out in a Facebook thing, so it's actually going to be problematic. Let me see if I can make it larger. Watch it not even want to play. Come on. Come on. Oop. Whoa. Hey now. Stop that. Stop that. And play.
There's an inherent trust that when you Google something, you are seeing the actual factual answer to your query or question based at least in part on the results of what other people are actually searching for. In the case of Hillary Clinton, who clinched the Democratic nomination, we know for a fact that that is not the case. Thanks to the help of our editor, Spencer Reed, SourceFed has discovered that Google has been actively altering search recommendations in favor of Hillary Clinton's campaign, so quietly that we were unable to see it for what it was until today. When we type Hillary Clinton CRI into Google, the site's autocomplete function shows three potential searches: Hillary Clinton crime reform, Hillary Clinton crisis, and Hillary Clinton crime bill 1994. However, when you type the same term, Hillary Clinton CRI, into Google's competitors Bing and Yahoo, you get very different results, focusing on whether or not Hillary Clinton has ever committed a crime. There's clearly something wrong here, right? Maybe people are just searching for different things on Google than on Yahoo or Bing. When we searched for Hillary Clinton crime reform, the top result from earlier, there weren't even enough searches of the term to build a graph on the site, which begs the question, why on earth is it the first potential result? For comparison, we added a second search term, Hillary Clinton crimes. Look what Google gave back. Apparently, far more people are searching for Hillary Clinton crimes than Hillary Clinton crime reform. Google just doesn't want you to know or ask. But hey, maybe that's a fluke, right? We tried it again, this time to see if Hillary Clinton's much-discussed potential indictment by the FBI would show up. When you type Hillary Clinton IND into Bing or Yahoo, there are plenty of indictment-based recommendations. But when you type it into Google, the top two recommended auto-completions are Hillary Clinton Indiana and Hillary Clinton India. When we entered them both into trends, people were searching for Hillary Clinton indictment 8 times more often than Hillary Clinton India. The intention is clear. Google is burying potential searches for terms that could have hurt Hillary Clinton in the primary elections over the past several months by manipulating recommendations on their site. We searched for negative terms that have been associated in the media with Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump on all three sites, specifically Bernie Sanders SOC for socialist and Donald Trump RAC for racist or racism. This time, Google matched the recommendations of Bing or Yahoo. No visible tampering. Google's bias here is undeniable, but at this stage, I must be clear. We at SourceFed are not accusing any individuals of any crimes. If this warping of search recommendations is as intentional as it appears to be, Google didn't break any laws in doing so. It's deeply unethical and wrong, but not illegal, and there is no proof that Hillary Clinton or any members of her campaign pushed for or knew about this practice. What we've discovered about Google's potential actions is shocking and deeply disturbing. If it is proven that the intentional manipulation of search results and recommendations has occurred, then Google and Eric Schmidt are in the clearest of wrongs here. There is no proof of any kind that the Hillary Clinton campaign asked for or was aware of any wrongdoing, and for myself or anyone else to assume or allege so is irresponsible. That's what we have. Search everywhere for information. Arm yourselves. Let's start over and look at the facts, and then vote. I'm Matt Lieberman. Thanks for watching.
So there you go.
Yeah, that was an asparagus course.
Yeah. Yeah, well, good old asparagus, it definitely leaves that that after smell, you know, so you'll know that you had it.
Yep.
So I'm not sure there are ways that Google tailors the search results per the user. So I'm going to get out right in front of this and say that if they did not switch to incognito mode first, then it will tailor your search results based on your search history. Therefore, you will get a biased result based on your own biases. It's strange because Google will then put you into your own bubble, which is not wrong, but it's bad because then you're not exposed to everything else. But what they're really doing is they're trying to give you what you want. There's obviously a bit of a danger there. Now, with with Bing and Yahoo, Yahoo uses Bing as the search engine. Just an FYI. They no longer have their own search property anymore. They outsource everything to Bing. There's really two search engines, unless you wanted to go to the Chinese search engines. And I have no idea what they would bring back. It'd be very interesting, given how restrictive the government is over those agencies.
Fair.
Yeah. So, and it is all about fair, and it is all about cognitive biases. Now, I've got in the morning section here, if you will, a little ranty Cliff Notes version. I've got some quick definitions for confirmation bias, herd mentality, or also known as mob mentality, the bandwagon effect, the illusion of control, reactance, and conspiracy. So, these things. Well, let's talk a little bit quickly about what has happened this week that prompts all this crap.
Oh, and the unpacking begins.
The unpacking begins. So, many of you may know, unless you literally were living under a rock, or maybe in Iraq, depending on your pronunciation, you may not know that the California primaries happened, along with New Jersey and several other states, along with the Virgin Islands and various other things. So, actually, over the weekend, after the less than notable, really, Virgin Islands primary and the what should we call those, the territories,
those are territorial or principality sort of regions.
Yeah, so they cast their ballot, they cast their lot, and the Associated Press, after taking those results, declared Hillary the winner. They called her the wording choice is what's going to trip everybody up here. The presumptive nominee. Okay? Words have meanings.
Yeah.
We know this, especially on this show when we kind of, you know, dive into that. And I mean, heck, I got six definitions here on screen.
Well, you know, again, here's where I am ready in wait to pounce down the AP's throat. Because we're already getting reports from other news sources that this push for, you know, we have declared her the presumptive, was literally a series of phone calls to superdelegates going after the question was, after the territorial vote, are you still supporting Hillary Clinton?
Yeah.
That was the question. Are you still supporting Hillary Clinton? Which, later on, we'll get to why that question is bad.
It's a loaded question. It is a biased question. In many of these cases, A, they only call the people that they already had as on the record as being Hillary supporters. People that have gone on and said, yes, I'm a Hillary supporter, you know, as the superdelegates. They called them, and their wording choice as Daniel said, kind of led the question. It's something that you wouldn't allow in a courtroom, or at least you'd be able to object to. Is that going too far?
No. No, that's incredibly accurate. No, the other thing that's, again, driving me batty about this entire election cycle is, okay, basic journalism ethics, something that you're required to take in college if you're getting a journalism degree.
Yeah.
A lot of what's gone on violates basic, like, bottom of the barrel, salt of the earth sort of ethics.
Yeah.
The things that everyone's supposed to abide by.
We would like the media to be impartial. We just want the news. We want to make our own opinion, right? Well, when was the last time you were able to do that? I think it was Walter Cronkite.
No. It actually goes back a little bit further.
Well, it goes back further, but who was the last one?
The last one where we didn't get quite so much a spin up until right before he retired was actually Brokaw.
Tom Brokaw,
Yeah. As a news anchor and journalist on a national stage, he was the last one.
And when did Tom Brokaw
retire? I have no clue.
2004. Thomas John Tom Brokaw is an American television journalist and author, best known as the anchor and managing editor of NBC Nightly News from 1982 to 2004. Thank you, Wikipedia.
So that tells you how long we've been on this. We've been without a great deal of journalistic ethics, and
12 years for those that can't do the math.
and here's the crazy thing: like it was already, I want to say it was already transitioning, to where people were starting to get their news instead of from the regular television nightly news sources. People were starting to push for more stuff online.
Yeah.
Also, you had the transition of being able to rely on your local and national newscasts that people were already beginning to switch over to, where a lot of people for a long time went to get news, reliable news.
Yeah.
Even though it has spin, and that was to comedy late night shows.
Well, speaking of Comedy Central, The Daily Show, where more people get their news than probably should. You know, it was a tongue-in-cheek approach to the very thing that we're talking about.
Yeah. And now, also, FYI, folks, John and Steve aren't there anymore. And Daily Show's a little bit more bias now with Trevor Noah. Instead of calling it down the line, there's more of that media bias in. The last guy that you have on Comedy Central that seems to have is more going to just keep throwing punches to everyone in the room is Larry Wilmore.
Yeah.
Because if you want to have yourself a good time, go look at him hosting and anchoring the press correspondence dinner.
Yeah, but that got so much controversy. He really.
But he pulled no punches.
He did. He did not pull punches. That is very true. But boy, was he on thin ice. Yeah,
but that was great.
That enraged my parents. Absolutely enraged them. So, anyway, we're not going to belabor that point. You can go look at him. But really, who are we talking about as being like the most journalistically the people with the most integrity? We're talking about comedians. What kind of world are we living in where the comedians have the most journalistic integrity?
We've gone back to the Middle Ages.
Oh, no. That's right. The court jester is the only one that actually told the truth. And he had to do it by making you laugh, otherwise you'd kill him.
Yeah, we've gone back to that point.
So, just as a refresher, I pruned a lot of these out of rationalwiki.org, which is a great website that tries to keep everything as factual as possible. So confirmation bias is the tendency to interpret new evidence as confirming one's existing beliefs or theories.
The bubble.
It's the bubble. And we all have one. We all have one, okay? I don't care who you are, but you have the people that you talk to regularly. And a lot of them, to hearken back to something that I guess it was like Secrets of Successful People or something like that. I can't remember where it was. But it's been an axiom that has rung true for an awfully long time. You are the sum of the five people you hang out with the most. You know, that those people become you. Or I should reverse that. You become those people. Your mannerisms, the way you think, the word choices that you use, what you find offensive, what you find acceptable, all of those things are influenced by your peer group. So, one, if you decide that your life is not where you want to be, change who you hang out with. I know it's hard because then we're getting rid of friends and things like that, but you know what? Some friends are just not good for you. So take that for what you will. But that also influences that confirmation bias. It also leads into herd mentality or mob mentality, which describes how people are influenced by their peers to adopt certain behaviors, follow trends, or purchase items. Examples of herd mentality include stock market trends, even superstition, even home decor, what you find you like in your house.
Fashion.
Absolutely, fashion.
All herd mentality.
Mm-hmm. And then that leads into the bandwagon effect, the tendency to do or believe things because many other people do or believe the same thing. It's related to groupthink, crowd psychology, herd behavior, and manias.
Beatlemania, folks.
Yeah. And then, of course, there's things that are a little bit more esoteric, like just the illusion of control, which is the tendency for human beings to believe that they can control or at least influence outcomes that they really can't. Now, that's big because it's really hard for us to grasp because there are some things, like, say, the election, that are not in our control. Okay? That really, I'm bringing all this back to politics and the politics of our election. So let's move on to reactance, and that's the urge to do the opposite of what someone wants you to do out of a need to resist the perceived attempt to constrain your freedom of choice.
Oh, that's been, we've been dealing with that for, about 12 years.
At least that. It's just very obvious now. It's always been there. And then, of course, conspiracy. Now, just to bring it down to basic terms, a conspiracy is a secret plan to achieve some goal. Its members are known as conspirators. A conspiracy theory originally meant the theory preformed conclusion that an event or phenomenon was the result of a conspiracy. However, from the mid-1960s onward, it's often used to denote ridiculous, misconceived, paranoid, unfounded, outlandish, or irrational theories. One of the worst things about conspiracy theories is the fact that they are almost airtight. Even debunking a piece of evidence against it will be viewed as an attempt to misinform the public. And the lack of evidence of it is viewed as a government cover-up. Not everyone involved in a conspiracy even necessarily knows all the details. In fact, sometimes none do. None even know that they're in a conspiracy. So you can take it to another level, but sometimes conspiracy theories, they hearken back to our pattern-seeking behavior because that's what keeps us alive as animals. We seek those patterns so that we can find food the next day, so that we recognize that a predator is on our tail. You know, the reptilian part of our brain is very big in pattern seeking. It's why we see animals in cloud shapes and things like that. Why we are predisposed to find a face in something. Why we could look at the front of a car and realize that the headlights are eyes and the grill is a mouth and things like that. You know, we're pattern seeking creatures. If you think otherwise, then I don't know what kind of world you live in. because that would be a very different world than the one that I'm in. So what really got me thinking about all this was how so many people think that there is a giant conspiracy to prevent Bernie Sanders from getting the election. Not all of them are right. Not all of them are wrong, either. There are things that are going on that are shady. Very, very shady. We've talked about it on this show numerous times because there's been too many numerous incidents. Weeks and weeks and weeks, we can go back. And we can find these little things that they just, they feel wrong on many levels.
There's been a lot of voter suppression in many different forms.
Yeah.
In almost every single primary.
But I can't chalk it up to a conspiracy theory. You know?
No, it's
grand. I don't think there's something grand. I think that what we have a lot of is people all thinking the same way and acting of their own accord towards the same goal in their own way. So that's when it becomes the illusion of control, the bandwagon effect, herd mentality, groupthink. You know, all of these things come together to have a large group of people all working towards a goal, doing little things that add up to a big result. You know, like voting. Voting in itself is kind of like that, but it's the accepted behavior. It's what we've all agreed to do. Actually, voting would be the grand conspiracy. Actually voting, where we're all a part of it. We're all doing it. We're all playing our part. Of course, that's the accepted thing, so we don't call it a conspiracy.
No, it's...
In theory, we're all conspiring to elect that one candidate, whoever it might be. You know, but that's just mincing of words. But is there a grand cabal that is preventing Bernie Sanders from getting the election nod? I don't think so.
Grandiose? No. But there are a lot of individuals out there that feel a responsibility, a need to try and push Hillary as the nominee.
Yeah.
And are willing to bend or outright break some rules to make that happen.
And of their own accord.
Yep.
These are people, independent rogue actors doing their own thing and for the greater good. You know, they can convince themselves of anything. Because remember, we're all the heroes of our own tale. You know, no one thinks they're the bad guy. Unless they're a sociopath. And even then, they probably think they're doing the right thing in their own context. It's hard to wrap your brain around. But if you think about it, you could be the bad guy. You could be. Depending on what you're doing. And what it affects other people. Like, was Google a willing participant in nudging the election one way or another? Was the AP, the Associated Press, were they a willing bad actor? Yeah, a willing participant in the grand conspiracy? Or were they simply doing what they thought everyone wanted to know? It's like, well, okay, at this point, she has hit that number, therefore she is the presumptive nominee. Technically, yeah, she is the presumptive nominee if you take into account the superdelegates, which don't vote yet. They haven't voted yet. And unfortunately, I mean, we've talked about it on this show many times.
Exhaustively.
That they don't vote until the convention, therefore we should not count them. It's simple. Do we think that they're going to vote a certain way? Yeah, we do. I mean, yeah. But things can happen.
To make a giant assumption like that is unethical. Let's just use the big word. It's unethical.
Well, especially the night before the biggest single voting day in the campaign.
No, it's entirely unethical. And the thing is, this presumption of her being the nominee has gone on for months.
She was the presumptive nominee before they started. She was the presumptive nominee in 2009.
It's, again, our journalism as it is now has failed us.
Yeah.
Entirely.
Is it even journalism anymore? Have we?
Really, it isn't. Because yeah, it doesn't opinion. Have, it doesn't follow the rules.
Not the not the traditional rules.
You are more likely to find true journalism in the pursuit of sport and sports writing than you are in the political arena, entertainment, yeah. Anything that actually has a strong effect on your life, you're not going to find journalism there. It's the small things or the things that don't have much meaning. People are using the same journalistic tactics and ethics on the stuff that's bread and circuses.
It's really disturbed me over the last week hearing all this and hearing what I consider to be very intelligent people. In fact, factually, very intelligent people just be completely dismissive of the facts that, yeah, presumptive nominee is not real nominee. She has not actually hit the magic number legitimately.
Nominee.
Yeah. It is, she has to have those superdelegates in order to get there. That's why, if Bernie Sanders chooses to, it will carry in all the way through to the convention, where it can be a contested convention, and then it's death match with all the delegates.
And on top of that, you'll have the soup again. There's already this wicked nudging that, especially and here's the funny thing. We're seeing a lot of push against the superdelegates, not just internally within the Democratic Party, but from the exterior. Not just, you know, from independents, but from the Republican Party going, come on, guys, even we don't do this.
Yeah, there's been a lot of that. And all I'm hearing is just this victory lap.
That's what the media is carrying. It's just, and here's the thing, when you look at those that make a living doing political cartoons, editorials, and whatnot, stuff, in punditing like we're doing right now.
Yeah, that's what we are. We're not making news. We're commenting on the news.
Yeah. Is all these cartoons and whatnot of, no, the media as a whole and the establishment putting Hillary on a litter and just waltzing her across everybody.
A litter, for those of you that are not familiar with that term in history, is the big cart that a chair with poles on the side that was carried by slaves or willing servants, where the person sat in opulence on a throne and was carted through.
Essentially what's happened with our media.
Yeah. So, actually, that would be a great cartoon. Somebody needs to draw that with Hillary on there and with, like, yeah. NBC, CBS, you know,
MSNBC,
ABC at the Four Corners.
CNN, and et cetera. Yeah, each of them just carrying her along. And I think one of the back, like, left one is the DNC itself.
Yeah, that's true. So, though there may not be a grand conspiracy, there is a great deal of groupthink that is subtly pushing this entire election process, and some not so subtly, very far to her corner. What will that mean come the actual convention, and then what will come of that when the presumptive nominee is actually going against Trump, who is also technically the presumptive nominee. Technically.
Hasn't he hit the golden number?
Yeah, he has. But still, they haven't crowned him king.
They haven't had the convention. They haven't had the party.
Right. They could still pull some shenanigans.
Very doubtful, considering
it's way doubtful.
we've been hearing and seeing from the Republican establishment. I mean, even before, when he was still a long shot,
even there was even people that they've already sold in their actual credentials and backed him now.
Yeah, but no, even back when he was a long shot, there was essentially almost like an old-time pamphlet going around the GOP going, hey, so just in case, crazy as it is, just in case this guy is the nominee, here are things to incorporate, here are things to say, here are things to not say, and here's how to incorporate some of the Donald's winning strategies into your election campaign.
Oh. Wow.
And that was happening. I don't want to overestimate it, but I don't want to underestimate it either, so I'm going to try and get a good number. About 3 months back. I want to say 3 months back.
Yeah. Time has no meaning for me anymore. I mean, I am so beaten down by this whole process because nothing makes sense. You know, why is there so much voter shenanigans? Because, okay, there's an awful lot of people, again, all on the Hillary side, on the winner, because the winner ends up writing the history. They're saying that, no, there was no voter fraud. That, no, that there's simply more people in support of her. Whereas, if we look at California, California's very interesting. There was another great voter purge. There were a lot of people that were taken off the rolls, and then, but not necessarily off the rolls, where they came in and they weren't showing up and then had to cast a provisional ballot, which apparently ended up some garbage chute somewhere. Like a third of them. There was presumptive voter switching at polls, where the number of votes that went for Hillary are actually the number of votes that went for Bernie, and, you know, flipped, just straight up flipped. When you have rallies with over 100,000 people in attendance, 100,000 people for one candidate, for one guy that has been saying the same thing for his entire career, like, you're not going to hear anything new. You might get a bird on stage. I mean, that was cool. But he's been saying the same thing, so you're not going to hear anything new. This is a rally of show of support.
And here's something else that's nothing new, especially coming from my lips. Follow the money.
Yeah, it is. It's a law.
Follow the money in sort of like almost the reverse fashion. Bernie's entire campaign has been based upon small individual donations.
By how much? $27.
Yes, but here's the psychology behind this.
Yeah,
when you personally invest in a candidate's campaign, you become vested.
Yes,
in that candidate and them winning. You become invested to the point that you will go to the polls and you will vote for him. You will, because your money is at stake. You have made an investment. You want to see that investment pay off.
And that is so huge,
That's just the psychology of it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you you're having these hundreds of thousands of small donations going to this man, and not being reflected in votes at the polls, something's wrong.
Well, also, okay, with the same polling numbers, I mentioned the 100,000 number because that was insane. And then you contrast it with the number of people that would show up at a Hillary rally. And it'd be maybe 1,000. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't get it. I don't understand. Mama Van, thank you very much for showing up, and we will see you next week. So hopefully you'll catch us in syndication, in reruns, as it were. So, Thank you very much for being in the chat room. Any listeners out there catching us later, you can always join us in the chat room every Friday. We're here chatting it up, obviously. If you're listening now, then you know that. And you, too, can change the shape of the show. We watch that chat room as it goes by, and we will pay attention. We will pay attention. So I don't understand how so few people that show up to her rallies could then in mass show up at the polls. The numbers there don't add up.
Again, it's all, yeah. If you just use simple science and observation, there's something wrong.
And is this confirmation bias on my part? Or am I in that bandwagon that thinks that those are the people that are going to show up because I'm seeing them? Maybe there is some of that bubble. You know, I'm obviously in a bubble because there are very few people that I associate with regularly that are going, that were adamant Hillary supporters. Most of them were the, I want Bernie to win, but if he doesn't, then I'll go with her. I think it's hashtag, I guess I'm with her. You know, something like that.
It's more hashtag, so this is what it's going to be.
Hashtag, sigh, I'm with her.
Yeah, that should be a bumper sticker.
Sigh, comma, I'm with her.
Hashtag before it, because that'll sell more.
Oh, yeah, of course, because everything's a hashtag now. That just seems to be the way of it. Okay, so enough of that.
We'll have more veggies to swallow later.
Yeah. Well, we got a little bit more, because we got history, and then we got the logical fallacy, and then we'll get into some juicy science here. So with that, let's hear from Fred. Hey, Fred, where are you? Where are you? See if this
Give
works.
Us some tasty history.
There it goes. Except he's not going. Here he goes.
Good evening, O'Reilly Radio listeners. I am not here tonight. Obviously, you probably picked that up in the beginning of the show, but I'm still here for our history. Today in history brings us one of the biggest contributions to this show actually existing today. The night of June 10th, 1752 was a stormy one. Thunderstorms, actually. The face of the $100 bill, Ben Franklin, used one of those storms to demonstrate the electrical nature of lightning. For approximately a decade previous, Franklin had been conducting electrical experiments in an effort to expand the knowledge on the topic. He is attributed with coining a number of terms used today, including battery, conductor, and even electrician. Franklin was also the inventor of the lightning rod, which is obviously used to protect buildings and ships. Most of these achievements stemmed from flying of a kite on the night of June 10th, 1752. And while I'm on the subject of things that are shocking, I'd like to list a few names for you. Victoria Woodhull, Jill Stein, Shirley Chisholm, and even Roseanne Barr. These are all women that if Hillary Clinton becomes the Democratic nominee for president in 2016, all of these women would have the distinction of having been a nominee before Clinton. Now, there would be caveats to this claim, obviously, as Clinton would be the first to have won a major party's nomination via the primary, and possibly the first to be considered to have an actual shot to win the presidency. My point is, as always, that history is so much deeper than what you're told by those around you. Some significant history is being made during these presidential primaries. Don't let that history become buried under the popular narrative of today, like the names of those women who paved the path for Hillary to even have a shot. That's all for our history tonight. Quick, brief, but poignant. And let's check out a logical fallacy. Have a great night.
Thank you, Fred. Okay.
And on that transition, I'd best pick it up. So, tonight's fallacy is the complex question fallacy. Complex question fallacy is committed when a question is asked that A, rests on a questionable assumption, and B, to which all answers appear to endorse that assumption. Example, have you stopped being your wife? This is a complex question because it presupposes that you used to beat your wife. a presupposition that either answer to the question appears to endorse.
Oop, hang on.
And then there's...
Apparently we're supposed to wrap up.
Are you going to admit that you're wrong? Answering yes to this question is an admission of guilt. Answering no to the question implies that the accused accepts that he is in the wrong, but will not admit it. No room is left to protest one's innocence. This is therefore a complex question and a subtle false dilemma.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Daniel.
Hi, O'Reilly Radio listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen, calling my voicemail to make sure that it still works. Please consider calling us, 470-222-6759. Bye. Hi, O'Reilly Radio listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen.
That was
if you wish to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe.
If you're scientifically literate, the world looks very different to you. It's not just a lot of mysterious things happening. There's a lot we understand out there. And that understanding empowers you.
If you base medicine on science, you cure people. If you base the design of planes on science, they fly. If you base the design of rockets on science, they reach the moon. It works, bitches.
That's right, science, bitches! Unfortunately, we don't have Mike this week, but I did come up with a few stories. Now, we are running a bit long because, as we heard a little bit earlier, my outro timer kind of went off in the middle of our logical fallacy. So, but I kind of expected that because the rant was, like, big. It just
unpacking...
So much, to unpack, and really, it deserved to be unpacked. So, really, I think this time around, we're just gonna go over it real quick. We're not gonna go in depth, but all the links are available.
Science.
Yeah, all the links are available on the show notes, which will be posted with the show, show 113A, at orlyradio.com. That's orlyradio.com. So you can get them right there. Okay. So the first one that I found was. It was out on Salon, but it was actually a reprint from Alternet that everything that that America has taught us about breakfast is a corporate myth. Apparently, it is not the most important meal of the day. But I still love breakfast, personally.
Breakfast is awesome.
Yeah, it may not be the most important meal of the day, but it is the meal that I like the best. Just as a quick note about the word breakfast, it's a compound word of break and fast. So in the morning, you are breaking your fast. It is breakfast. Little etymology there. Since while you're sleeping, you're not eating. So you're kind of fasting while you're sleeping. There you go. Fasting, not eating, breaking your fast, breakfast. Yay! Breakfast of Champions. So apparently, let's see where it says here. Many of the studies are funded by the food industry, which has a clear bias. Again, more biased information. Kellogg funded a highly cited article that found that cereal for breakfast is associated with being thinner. The Quaker Oats Center of Excellence, part of PepsiCo, financed a trial that showed that eating oatmeal or frosted cornflakes reduces weight and cholesterol if you eat it in highly controlled settings each weekday for 4 weeks. You know, the Circle K diet, remember that? Yeah, oh no, Special K. Circle K is a convenience store. I mean Special K. Which is different, obviously.
One diet will make you blow up. The other diets might, no.
Who knows what you're going to get at the Circle K, you know? So writing for Alternet in an essay on the corporate breakfast myth, Anneli Rufus reported seeking to provide sanitarium patients with meatless, anti-aphrodisiac breakfast in 1894, Michigan Seventh-day Adventist surgeon and anti-masturbation activist John Kellogg developed the process of flaking cooked grains, hence cornflakes, hence Rice Krispies, hence a rift between Kellogg and his business partner brother who wanted to sweeten Kellogg's cereals in hopes of selling more. Guess who won? In pre-cornflakes America, breakfast wasn't cold or sweet. It was hot, hearty, and lardy. And it had about 4,000 calories. Good golly!
Well, look at the traditional Irish breakfast, which is, you know, a giant meal.
You're breaking your fast, so you're hungry. That's it. So, breakfast was the biggest meal of the day, eaten before you headed out to do a whole day of farm chores. It had to keep you going until dinner, says food historian Andrew F. Smith, author of Eating History, 30 Turning Points in the Making of American Cuisine, Columbia Press, 2009. Pre-industrial Americans loaded up on protein-rich eggs, sausage, ham, and American-style belly fat bacon, along with ancient carb classics, mush, pancakes, and bread. The great cereal shift mirrored and triggered other shifts, farm to factory, manual to mechanical, cowpuncher to consumer, snake oil superstition to science. Biggest of all was food's transition from homegrown food butchered to store-bought. Cold cereals are an invention of vegetarians and health food industry. First through Kellogg's and then through CW Post, which steals all of Kellogg's ideas. Which is true. We have seen that in the good old corporate America. These companies realized early on that people like sugar, and kids really like sugar. So they shifted their sales targets from adults concerned about health to kids who love sugar. And it's thoroughly American invention. Now, if you're in the grocery stores, you'll see that the really sugary cereals, and kind of the more expensive ones, are at kid eye level. This is on purpose. So that when kids go through the aisle, when they're shopping with mom and dad, they see that and they say, I want Frosted Flakes. Yeah, I want the Tony the Tiger, the big cartoon looking guy whose eyes actually follow you. If you look at the box, they kind of follow you. That's the way they're drawn on purpose. Corporate advertising is directly targeting little kids with this stuff to get you hooked. And then you've got all these sugary, sweet memories of your childhood eating Frosted Flakes or Cocoa Pebbles or, you know,
whatever
it happens to be, Sugar Bomb Pops or whatever, you know. You're going to remember all those, and you're going to want them later in life when you're a super-duper type 2 diabetes adult. Yay! And that's kind of the way things are going. I do love a big old 4,000-calorie breakfast, though, which is probably bad, but, you know, it is the way it is. So orange juice has also come to symbolize purity in a glass, writes agricultural expert Alyssa Hamilton in Squeezed, What You Don't Know About Orange Juice, Yale University Press, 2009. Her research reveals a highly processed product whose use of cheaply grown foreign fruit now mandates a massive carbon footprint. So not only is that orange juice not necessarily the right thing for you, it may also be destroying the planet. Congratulations, America.
No, if you want your orange juice, try and buy local.
Try and buy local, absolutely. It also just tastes better. I don't know why, but well, around here...
I can easily tell you why.
Well, it's not.
My grandfather used to work for Florida orange groves down in Palm Beach County.
Yeah.
I grew up next to a ton of groves. Part of that is because... a byproduct of its carbon footprint. In shipping, the orange juice has to have more preservatives put into it.
Yeah.
Also, entropy happens. So those sugars degrade over time. So the fresh stuff tastes better because those sugars have not entropied. Also, you're not dealing with as many preservatives being shoved into the product.
Yeah.
This is one of those things. Fresh is better, especially with your orange juice.
Yeah.
So buy local if you can, and by all means, for our Florida listeners, I mean Indian River, it's not going that far to meet you.
I live next to the Indian River, just to give you an idea.
Yeah, and then you know, Florida grown. Just try and find stuff that's actually harvested here, bottled here.
Yeah, if you're in California, find California oranges.
Yeah,
you know,
by all means, get that. Yeah. Or if you're in a place that doesn't produce oranges, try and buy from the state that is closest to you.
Yeah,
it does reduce your carbon footprint. If you care about the environment, try and buy local.
Yeah. In the book series by Daniel Suarez, the Damon and Freedom TM, duology there. In Freedom TM, when they're trying to rebuild things, I don't want to give too many spoilers, but they work on a concept called a Holland, or a Holon, I think, where everything in that community has to be sustainable within a 100-mile radius. Which means that that community is essentially self-sufficient. Because that's not really that far. But boy, is there a lot that can be done in 100 miles.
Oh, yeah.
So,
one of my biggest complaints about living in Florida, also in the States in general, is public transit is awful.
Yeah.
Because we don't plan for it.
No, it's definitely not planned for. You know, we're barely able to have the interstate highway system. And even that was, a public's work progress to also to allow the military to get from one side of the coast to the other side.
So, infrastructure is good, folks.
Infrastructure is good. It's fantastic. We need better infrastructure. So that one caught my attention. It's like, yeah, I got to talk about this one. So,
come on, 4,000 calorie breakfast. What's not to talk about?
Exactly. And, that's fine if you're a farmhand. If you're going to go out and you're going to burn those calories, then that's fine. You're going to have that big hearty breakfast. But if you're an office worker, you don't need the pancakes.
Grapefruit's great, folks.
Yeah, there is the grapefruit diet. Yeah. Low in calories. It will at least satiate the hunger through all of its, yeah.
Fruit is good with a little bit of meat that'll carry you through to lunch.
When did I have my last grapefruit? I can't remember. It's been a long time because I don't really like grapefruit. I'll just be honest. No.
Find a fruit that you like.
But a nice big ruby red grapefruit. Those are okay. I can go with those. Okay. So, moving right along, in quick succession here, scientists have been able to turn bacteria into living hard drives by storing 100K in their DNA. And then they were able to process their genome and actually get that data back after they had replicated several colonies. Pretty big stuff. I mean, that 100K is not much. Certainly not much.
Right now.
Not right now. And that's a colony of E. coli in a petri dish, dying off and rebreeding several times, through their life cycle. And then, of course, you have to go through the entire process of decoding their genome in order to get it back. So it's definitely not random access or anything like that. It's not going to do any of that. But for long-term storage, it might be something. Might be something to that. It's definitely the start of something beautiful.
Biocomputing is the future.
That's right. And speaking of DNA, physicists confirm there's a second layer of information hidden in our DNA. Theoretical physicists have confirmed that it's not just the information coded into our DNA that shapes who we are. It's also the way DNA folds itself that controls which genes are expressed inside our bodies. That's something that biologists have known for years, and they've been able to figure out some of the proteins responsible for folding of the DNA. But now a group of physicists have been able to demonstrate for the first time through simulations how this hidden information controls our evolution. Now, this is two disciplines, biology and physicists, combining their efforts towards our genome, towards DNA. I love it when different disciplines of science have to work together and come up with amazing results. So,
this is why we need to invest in NASA.
Yeah, it's all science. It's all just science. I don't care if it's biological science or physical sciences or theoretical sciences. It's all science. You got to work on it all soup to nuts. It's a big thing. No little detail can be left out. You know, if you can explore it through the scientific method, it's important. So let's back up here for a second. Because although it's not necessarily news to many scientists, this second level of DNA information might not be something you're familiar with. As you probably learnt in high school, learned. As you probably learned in high school, Watson and Crick discovered in 1953 that the DNA code that determines who we are is made up of a sequence of letters, G, A, C, and T. The order of these letters determines which proteins are made out of our cells. So if you have brown eyes, it's because your DNA contains a particular series of letters that encodes for a protein that makes the dark pigment inside your iris. But that's not the whole story. Of course not. Otherwise, we wouldn't be talking about it. Because all the cells in your body start out with the exact same DNA code, but every organ has a different function. Your stomach cells don't need to produce brown eye protein, but they do need to produce digestive enzymes. So how does that work? Since the 80s, scientists have found that many DNA is folded up inside our cells actually controls this process. Environmental factors can play a big role in this process, too, with things like stress known to turn certain genes on and off, through something known as epigenetics, which is fun if you ever want to really dive into something. In fact, there was in the book just out more recently, Seven Eves. Later in the back half of the book, there's something known as going epi. So I'll just leave that to your imaginations, and I don't want to spoil anything in the book, but it's really interesting. But the mechanics of the DNA folding in this original control mechanism, folding is the original control mechanism. Sorry, I'm reading too quickly. That's because every single cell in our body contains around 2 meters of DNA. 2 meters? Whoa. So to fit inside us, it has to be tightly wrapped into a bundle called a nucleosome, like a thread around a spool. And the way that DNA is wrapped up controls which genes are read by the rest of the cells. Genes that are wrapped on the inside won't be expressed as proteins, but those on the outside will. This explains why different cells have the same DNA, but different functions. In recent years, biologists have even started to isolate the mechanical cues that determine the way DNA is folded by grabbing onto certain parts of the genetic code or changing the shape of the spool of DNA the DNA is wrapped around. So as we continue on, it's a team from Leiden University in the Netherlands has now been able to step back and look at the process on a whole genome scale and confirm through computer simulations that these mechanical cues are actually coded into our DNA. So not only is all the information there, but the way to read the information is also encoded in. So, kind of like a checksum.
And again, I just love that you're using physicists, which are trying to still marry the rules of the really, really big with the really, really small.
Yeah, absolutely. And DNA is really, really small. Because we've had stories before, you know, recently even, where they're trying to store data that isn't DNA data, isn't, you know, genetic data, but data like that of the 100K that was put into the bacteria, into the E. coli, putting that into DNA and using DNA as the ultimate storage device. So with that, I'm going to leave this off. The research was published in PLOS One, PLOSONE, which is a journal of letter. It's noted.
But by all means, folks, if this is interesting to you, go to the website. Check the show notes. Go further.
Absolutely. And I'm going to skip down to the last one and then back up to the other one. So a new immune therapy drug gives bladder cancer patients a fresh hope. So a newly approved drug that gives immune system a boost helped stall the spread of tumors in patients with advanced bladder cancer. So advanced bladder cancer. It's not a slam dunk, but it's another piece of good news for the latest approach in treating cancer by harnessing the body's immune system. The drug called, oh wow, that's a crazy name, Atezolizumab?
Wow. Atezolizumab.
I don't. Can you say that again? I don't know if you can.
Atezolizumab.
Nope, you couldn't say it again. No, it's different every time.
Atezolizumab.
It's Atezolizumab.
Atezolizumab.
The show is basically just going to be how badly can we pronounce this drug? Anyway, it's sold under the brand name
Tecentriq.
Tecentriq? Yeah.
Tecentriq.
Yeah, with a Q at the end because it's fancy. It works in a similar way to Keytruda. The drug credited with stopping former President Jimmy Carter's advanced melanoma. So in the study, the treatment stopped tumors from growing in 24% of advanced bladder cancer patients and shrank them by 30%, the team told a meeting of the American Society of Clinical Oncology in Chicago. So I again implore you to go take a look at this. It is a pricey drug, but you know what? Your money or your life is what it comes down to in this country.
We really need healthcare reform.
Yeah. It is $12,500 a month currently.
If you're wealthy, it's great. If you're poor, well, get ready to die.
Yeah, well, that's the Republican healthcare plan, right? You know, die quickly. I think that's what Senator Alan Grayson said. Well, congressman. Yeah, he's Congressman Alan Grayson. He has not yet secured Rubio's position. Hopefully he will, though. good stuff. Okay. And lastly, under science, the Zika virus might also spread via oral sex, says French researchers. Yep. Oh la la. Yeah.
There's got to be a joke in there somewhere.
There should be, but this is no laughing matter, obviously. The Zika virus, spread mostly by mosquitoes, might also travel via oral sex. It's known that sex can spread Zika virus, which can remain in the man's semen for weeks and even months. In an excruciatingly detailed report, a team of researchers at France's INSERM, I-N-S-E-R-M, M, S-E-R-M, Medical Institute, describe a case they think suggests that oral sex might also spread the virus. It started with a woman who got sick in Paris last February. She got the classic Zika rash and muscle aches and had not been to any Zika-affected areas, but a man she knew had been in Rio and also had a rash. So they call her Patient One. So, Zika's just going to be a thing that we're going to have to live with for a while, it looks like, at this point, until finally we get some sort of vaccine, because
this is, for any of you gamer fans out there who have been playing Pandemic, this is it. This is it in real life.
Yeah, patient one reported sexual contact between February 11th and February 20th, with a man, patient two, the index patient, who had stayed in Brazil from December 11th, 2015 through February 9th, 2016. Dr. Eric D'Entenzio? D'Entenzio. Okay. And colleagues wrote in a letter in the New England Journal of Medicine. The 46-year-old man also had a rash that cleared up when he traveled from Brazil to France. The sexual contact involved 7 episodes of both vaginal intercourse with ejaculation and without the use of a condom, and oral sex with ejaculation, they added. So maybe it was oral sex. Maybe it was the other sex without the condom. But apparently, and though this was known to science, medical science, I personally had not heard that Zika could be transmitted via sperm. Did not know that.
Again, it is an aggressive disease, especially in its propagation.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why we really need to stop having people block funding to research this.
Oh, geez. Zika can also be found in saliva. Okay, that's reasonable. And urine. And the doctors note that saliva may be the culprit, but they don't think so. So urine, too, which means that then it's also making it into municipal water systems.
Though usually how municipal water is treated, it's very aggressive.
Certainly, yes.
It's very rare for a biological agent to survive.
In the United States.
Fair point.
Not all countries are created equally, especially in their disposal of
municipal
human waste.
Water, yeah.
Yeah, so this could be ugly.
Yeah, again, second, third world nations, this can get ugly fast.
We cannot rule out the possibility that transmission occurred not through semen, but through other biological fluids, such as pre-ejaculate secretions or saliva exchanged through deep kissing. Deep kissing, says the French researchers. I'll leave it there. Go ahead and check this out. Oh, also, she was 24 and he was 46. 46. So, a little cradle robbing there. Anyway.
Hey, it's France.
Who am I to say? So, with that is going to wrap up the first half of the show. So we'll be back live next Friday about 9:30 p.m. Eastern, barring any unforeseen technical difficulties, as per usual. The second half of the show will drop on Wednesday morning. In the meantime, the conversations continue on the web. Head over to ORLYRADIO.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com for all the links at the top of the page. So you can like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and subscribe to the YouTube and Twitch channels. That way you'll know when we go live. Of course, you can watch us live and join in all the fun in the chat room and all from our webpage. I will eventually have all this script, like, completely working, and I'll not stumble through it. I swear, one day, I'm not sure when that day will be, but one day I'll be able to do it. And if you've stayed with us Okay. Hey, if you've made it this far, you probably like the show. So how about you give us a hand? If you have a few dollars to spare, you can contribute to the Patreon and get early access to the show release and even get some special perks. Just follow the Patreon link on the webpage and or just head over to patreon.com, patreon.com/ORLYRADIO. And you can also make a one-time donation directly through the donate button. So if you can't fit us into your rainy day funds, it's fine. No problem. Completely understand. How about you do us a solid and share the show, or at least leave us a review. We're always looking for new ideas for the show. So how about you share what's on your mind? Shoot us a note at orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com or at just directly to me at andy@orlyradio.com. Or if you're the more talkative sort, we do have that voice line number at 470-222-ORLY or 6759, and it is always ready to take your call or your text. Can't thank you enough for spending some time with us. Till next time, this has been ORLY Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show is created by Kevin McLeod of incomptech.com. Now, if you're still here, in the live feed, that is, we'll see you in about 10 minutes. Otherwise, we'll catch you all on Wednesday. Doodles!